All right. Thank you for coming. Welcome to my talk about service mesh benchmarks. This talk will more focus on the benchmark part, like how we approach this benchmark, what may be worthwhile considering when you're doing your benchmarks, while we will present the results of the Istio versus Linkerd benchmarking at the end of this talk. It's really not the main focus of that talk, so if you came for a flame war, I'm sorry to disappoint you. Here we go. That's me. That's our Berlin office. I work for Kinfolk. We are the DeepStack Kubernetes experts. So we worked our way up from the operating system plumbing level at the beginning of Kinfolk through container runtimes and for a few years now also the Kubernetes level. And we also do conferences. This is about service mesh benchmarks. So we'll be taking a look at the scenario that we intended to test to basically map in our benchmarks and closely related to that, to the goals that we are pursuing with this benchmark and the metrics that we used in order to understand the scenario that we were looking at. The metrics will have a nice excursion into coordinated omission, which I think should be used when doing latency benchmarks, but currently isn't. It's not very widespread, the knowledge on that. We'll take a quick look on statistical robustness because we'll be benchmarking in an infrastructure as a service environment in a public cloud. And then we'll discuss cluster setup, where we're basically trying to map the concerns from the previous points into how the cluster was set up. And then we'll look at the results. All right. This is the most heavyweight part of the of the presentation. That's target scenario, benchmark, goals, and metrics, and a lot on coordinated omission. So the target scenario that we aimed to benchmark was to people switching from no service mesh at all to a service mesh. Like, what's the user experience like? We didn't use any fancy service mesh features for that. We didn't even use most of the basic features, except, of course, sidecar, HTTP, gRPC TLS injection, because that's a major benefit that everybody should be using when using service meshes. Benchmark goals were the overall user experience of the thing. So that is the experience your users will have when using your freshly meshed cluster. That includes end-to-end testing of many users accessing our demo app that we used for the benchmark. And also, and that'd be more interesting for you as cluster maintainers, is we'll be looking at the operational cost, resource consumption of whether it increases if you start meshing. We'll be looking at that under regular operating conditions, so there won't be any overload testing. We're not trying to kill your cluster, but we're interested in pushing to edge cases to better understand under regular operating conditions what can go wrong. So for the overall user experience, we were using latency as our metric. That is many users stampeding on your apps without overloading your cluster. And we'll be taking coordinated omission into account for those latency metrics. Operational cost, we didn't really go down and factor a dollar value into that, but we went as far as measuring the CPU and RAM consumption that the service meshes would impose on your cluster when you start meshing. And that's both for the control plane and for the proxy sidecars. The regular operating condition, as I said, no overload, no scale out. We'll be focusing on P99, P999, P99999 edge cases to better understand differences. All right, so we're looking at that and we're seeing that we're trying to measure latency in no overload scenarios. But I mean, if there's no overload, what's the point, right? And that's where coordinated omission comes in. That's a term. Brought up by Jill Teen, who's a Bay Area engineer, very interested in benchmarking, particularly latency. It focuses on the real-life user experience, which is exactly what we want to have for our benchmark. So it measures the overall latency that you will get instead of just looking at the latency of individual requests. And the reason, like the overarching reason for that is that most web applications will issue a number of requests, possibly a large number of requests, for a single user action, Because we're in the age of microservices, right? If like one single request would satisfy any user action, that would be microservices. So that's factored in. The target that we will be benchmarking must maintain a constant RPS rate, and that's the thing you'll feed into the benchmark when using the coordinated or mission-focused one. So we will be looking at the latency of requests when they were supposed to be sent instead of when they actually be sent. So benchmarks that wait in the queue and basically don't get their turn will increase in latency. And that's a latency that you do not see on the wire level. I think that makes it pretty clear, right? Or are you Jackie Chan right now? So let's go get a coffee to make it a little easier. That's a classical client-server setup. We have a client issuing a request. We have a server processing the request. And we're having a client getting a response. So when we have a queue, multiple people waiting to be served, and we have a waiter who claims to fulfill one cup per minute request rate. First client comes in, makes request, gets response, takes 0.8 minutes, we're good. Second client comes in, issues request, gets response, 1.1 minute. We're still good on average. It looks nice. Third client comes in, has a special request that takes the server a little longer, and we end up with a 5 minute latency. Fourth client comes in and gets served in 0.6 minutes. It did not feel that way. Honestly, when waiting in the queue for the coffee, it didn't feel like it felt for the first two folks, right? So yeah, let's fast forward. We get this result. On average, we're still good with one cup per minute because there's an outlier, obviously. So that thing is just dirty data. Let's rip it off. And we're happy. So the thing is, if you look at the last three clients, they don't really look that happy. And all of those requests make up a single user action. So the end result is basically a meh result for our user, which is in misalignment with our own results, basically. So we're happy. Our customers are not. And that's a bad thing. Let's see what we can do to improve. So if this first person issues their request at a point in time X, then we can calculate the points in time when the other folks will issue their requests, right? If we serve with one request per minute, then the next fork, the second fork in the line will issue their request at X.1, the next one X.2, the next one X.3. That's the latest point in time where they should issue their request. So let's fast forward to Mr. Pumpkin Spice Latte here. He goes away with 5 minutes latency. And now this guy doesn't really have 6 minutes latency. If we apply what we just discussed, then this guy actually has a 3.5 minute latency. Now, how's that? It's the fourth customer. So this guy would have issued their request at X plus 3 minutes. With a maximum latency of 1 minute. So it should have been fulfilled after x plus 4 minutes. It did not. This guy was only able to issue their request at x plus 6.9 minutes, because that's the piled up latency from the three forks in front of him. And it was, his request completed at x plus 7.5 minutes. Now, if you take the expectation of a maximum wait of 4 minutes until this guy gets his coffee, and the actual value of 7.5 minutes, you get a 3.5 minute latency. So if you go back and basically adjust the wait results of everybody else behind this guy in the queue, then you understand why the customers are looking so sad. And you understand that the server doesn't really fulfill the one cup per minute request rate. Now the server is looking slightly meh, and we're in alignment with our customer experience, right? So this is what this aims at. Coordinated omission, that's the same slide again, focuses on real life user experience. It measures overall latency because a user action consists of multiple requests. The target must maintain a constant RPS rate. We are taking expectations into account at what point in time a request would have been completed. And that's why you can't see this latency on the wire level. If you just trace packages, you will only see the request go out when it actually goes out. All right. If you can follow till here, you basically did the big communication part of this presentation. Let's look at statistical robustness. That's something that should come natural if you think about the quality of your data points in infrastructure as a service in public cloud environments. Just consider your greater benchmark environment. Consider the things you do not see that APIs and graphical user interfaces hide from you. Is it a closed system without crosstalk? Like, do you have your servers in the basement? Is the hardware of those servers representative for the class of the servers, or do you have a lemon server in there? Is there any noise? Do you have any side effects? And cloud providers give an SLA that always has a range, right? So if you do measurements, you want to understand the range that they have. Complementary to that, what's the expressiveness of the data points? Like, what do the deviations that we measure tell us? And what's the representativity of the whole set of data points, of cooked data points that that you gain? Now, in public cloud environments, you have a randomized placement of your servers, and it doesn't really matter whether they are virtual instances or physical servers from the provisioning algorithm, right? So where are your servers located physically, and what's the neighborhood like? Regarding your individual servers that you're gonna get with the provisioning dice roll, is the CPU, the RAM, the network interface controller hardware, is that representative of the class of servers that you're using? What's with the BIOS versions? BIOS versions have a strong impact of the on the performance in multiple scenarios of the hardware you're using. What's the position in the rack that your server has? Is it at the very top of the rack? And do you have maybe other servers from other customers just below you that are running on full speed, creating a little bit of heat? And do not allow your CPU to burst at all, because otherwise your server would overheat. What's the network like? What's the distance of the servers in the data center? Did you get, by coincidence, two servers in the same rack? Are they just located at different edges of the data center, and you have to cross quite a bit of network distance between them, which would increase the chance of having noisy neighbors in the middle? And yeah, public cloud providers can do things with software-defined networking, but that can only give you so much of bandwidth. So you can use the deviations. You can collect multiple data sets and use the deviations in your data sets to kind of gauge the environment you're working in. So if you want to harden against like one-time big events, I don't know, Prime Day, if you're in an Amazon cloud, then you could just run your benchmarks repeatedly multiple times. And you would basically detect in succeeding runs, successive runs, that there's a difference, and you would basically see your lemon run. If you want to harden against local systemic noise, that's noisy neighbors who just don't stop being noisy, or a data center switch that's faulty, then you just spread your clusters, deploy multiple clusters in multiple regions maybe even, and run your benchmark tests in parallel. So you're basically getting rid of the time relation in here. So let's take a look at our cluster setup that we used. And this is like working towards the results section. The hardware, we were using Packet, which is an infrastructure as a service provider that has a beautiful, nice, neat API where you can just deploy physical servers. You get bare metal speed. The server type we opted for specifically is C2 medium x86. Don't get distracted by the term medium. Those are quite powerful systems. They're powered by an AMD EPYC CPU 2018 generation, if I recall correctly. 24 cores, 48 threads. We used hyperthreading. We didn't switch off hyperthreading for this test. 64 gigs RAM and two 10 gigabit network interfaces, which work in bonded mode. Our cluster setup had a controller and five worker nodes. One of the five worker nodes was a dedicated load generator node, and the other four ran the application. The load generator node was picked at random for each run. So we had a little bit spread there as well. This is lacking contrast. This is how you can picture the setup that we were running. So you have the load generator node talking HTTP 1.1 to four application nodes. The software stack that we've been using, that we used for the benchmarks, well, we used our Locomotive Kubernetes distribution because it just allows for an easy one command provisioning of clusters and installation of Kubernetes. It's neatly automated. So it completely automates bring up for you, and that one was running on Flatcar Linux. So we have this stack where we have Flatcar Container Linux, which is a friendly fork of CoreOS Container Linux, and the Locomotive Kubernetes stack on top. So if we need to make any adjustments or make it work together, we basically have the full stack under our control, and all of that is open source. All right. The benchmark, the actual application that we've been using to benchmark is called Emojivoto. That's a demo application which is shipped with Linkerd for just playing around with Linkerd. It's not service mesh specific, it's service mesh agnostic. More than that, it doesn't even need a service mesh. And that was important for us because we also did bare metal benchmark runs because we wanted to understand the price you're paying for just running a service mesh. It's a great app for this kind of benchmark for two reasons. The first is it's a microservices app. It consists of three microservices. We'll have a look at that right away. And it's easily scriptable on the deployment level. So you can actually, deploy this app many, many times, just changing the service endpoint name. And we wanted that. We wanted a cluster with multiple apps that consist of multiple microservices each running for the benchmark. So Emojivoto really helped us a lot to do that. We wrote a little bit of scripting, benchmark automation that allows you to do that in a completely automated way and reproduce the results that we got from the benchmark. This is, again, lacking contrast, but that's what the app looks like. There's a load balancer type microservice, web SVC, that takes your HTTP requests, and there are emoji VPC, which serves emoji pictures, and voting SVC, which lets you vote on your favorite emojis, that are talking gRPC with the web SVC micro application. And what we did is we just gave it different names. We just post-fixed the number, so we had one app. In this example, it's four apps. I think we ended up using 20. Not entirely sure. Need to check my blog post. Each of those microservices is a separate pod, and all of those pods are basically cross-scheduled on the four application nodes that we've been using in our cluster for generating the benchmark load and measuring latency. We use WIK2. WIK2 is a fork of WIK by Jill Teen. It takes coordinated omission into account, so we get the real user experience data. It's asynchronous, multi-threaded. You can script it with Lua. It's freaking amazing. If you do HTTP benchmarks, please have a look. And we've extended it a little because the original WIK, as well as the original WIK2, only measure a single endpoint. And we added a feature so you can basically just distribute the load that this tool generated to as many endpoints as you want to, which was necessary for our benchmark. Here's the URL for WIK2, and this is our pull request that has the extension in it. Benchmark automation. Lets us provisioning the cluster automatically. So we were using Locomotive, as mentioned, and on Flatcar Linux. The hardware was completely automatically using APIs from packet setup. Kubernetes was installed, Flatcar was installed, Kubernetes was installed. And after that, the automation deployed Emojivoto and installed a service mesh. The automated benchmarking automation just ran the benchmark job, which is WIK2. Collected results from the job, and while the benchmark was running, was collecting resource usage data. That part, admittedly, should be a cloud-native application, but sadly, it's just the best script raw on kubectl. If you want to check it out, there it is. It just, you start a shell script, and you get to run the same benchmarks we did. Let's look at the results. So we used Istio 1.16. That was the current stable back in the day when we ran the benchmarks in May. We used it in two settings. One was stock Istio, which basically the configuration that came with Istio. The other, the demo configuration that came with Istio. The other was tuned Istio. So we basically iterated a lot on the Istio deployment and tuned everything that we could find to be tuned. We got feedback from the community after the benchmarks on the stock, that the stock configuration isn't really representative. And the reason for that is it's optimized for a very constrained hardware environment. So if you're looking at the charts right now, don't look at the dark blue part, only look at the light blue part. That's the tuned Istio. We also got feedback on the tuned Istio version, and we optimized that a little further and ran the benchmarks again. And there was no difference with what we've seen previously. We used Linkerd Edge because we feel that the Edge release cycle and quality that Linkerd shows is a lot closer to the actual Istio stable release cycle. The stable Linkerd release cycle is a lot slower, takes a lot more time. So Edge is a more appropriate comparison. At least it was back in the day in May. That's how we ran the benchmarks on two clusters and two separate regions. For Istio stock, Istio tuned, and we're going to ignore Istio stock in the results. Linkerd and bare metal, so no service mesh. Install the service mesh or not, if that's the bare test. Deploy Emojivoto, deploy the benchmark load generator, and that would kick off the benchmark. Get the resource usage while the benchmark's running. And after the benchmark job finished, pull the latency results from the benchmark job, delete benchmark job, Emojivoto, and uninstall the service mesh. So we basically have a clean slate for the next run. And this was run twice. In two separate regions, and that's where we got a little bit of statistical spread. 3 minutes left. Let's look at the results. These are our latency results for 500 requests per second run on Emojivoto for 30 minutes. So 30 minutes is extremely large, 8-time window for this kind of test. And as I said, we just wanted to push the differences. And if you look at the lower percentages, there are virtually no differences between any of the service meshes. It's just if you look at the higher percentiles for this insanely large time window that you start to see minor differences. We see Linkerd eating a little bit more than bare metal in terms of latency, and the light blue, which is the tuned Istio one, is a little bit ahead of that as well. If you look at those charts, please. Please understand that this is a logarithmic axis. So there are differences between those, but only if you really push it to extremes. Resource usage, we got a clear winner with Linkerd in terms of memory usage. So the tuned version of Istio takes a lot more memory, which isn't that bad as it looks like. This is only like a certain perspective on things. Istio comes loaded with a huge bunch of features. So all those features basically take a bit of resources. Same for CPU. No, actually, CPU utilization is pretty different. Linkerd is head-to-head with Istio on that one for the application proxy sidecar. So this is where it really matters, right? This is the actual traffic. This is the work. This is the service mesh control plane, also uses a few resources, but I wouldn't really put too much weight on that. What would count for me is the sidecar performance. All right, and then we got a little crazy and thought, let's do the same thing with 600 requests per minute, because we want to see latencies in the minute range, which you can get if you take coordinated omission into account. And right here, we see Istio basically taking off in that massive time window and having two-digit minute latency, which hints at that someone in the Linkerd development team, at least on the occasion, looks at benchmarks that take coordinated omission into account, and Istio hasn't quite committed themselves to this kind of measuring latency. Memory usage, there's no not much of a change from what we've seen previously. Please ignore the dark blue things. Control planes are comparable in terms of memory usage. Application proxy sidecar shows that Linkerd is a little leaner. We have a change law in the CPU resource usage, and we see the Linkerd sidecar eating a little more in terms of resource usage with this request per second setting. And one of the reasons for that may be the huge latencies that we've been seeing with Istio. So just packets not being processed as fast. What's the verdict? So when you switch from no service mesh to a service mesh, like, is there something that you should be concerned about? We can't know. Like, there isn't. Just do it. Just go to the, just put one up. You probably will not see significant resource usage, significant higher resource usage, or significantly higher latency. So this is, for a big part, to just take away the scare. And should you use Istio or Linkerd? Both are really, really fine, as I brought up in the charts a number of times. We just really pressed for a fringe case hard in order to see any difference at all. Linkerd has a great out-of-the-box user experience. We didn't do any tuning for Linkerd, right? No tunings in the deployments, no tunings anywhere. We just downloaded it, put it in a cluster. It just worked. And we spent quite a bit of time tuning the hell out of Istio. Istio is super flexible. It has a ton of features, and yeah, so those are the two. Thank you. Any questions? Yes, please.
Your bars and your graphs, was that the total, like for example, CPU usage, was that the total CPU usage, or was that the CPU usage over bare metal? Is that total memory usage or is that memory usage over bare metal?
It's the same. Because if you compare that against bare metal, there is no sidecar, right? And there is no service mesh control plane because it's bare metal.
Oh, right. Well, okay, go back to the CPU usage one though. You had metal on the CPU usage. Okay. Oh, no, you didn't.
No. CPU usage doesn't have bare metal because, I understand. No, we're just looking at service mesh items here. So that's the proxy sidecar that comes with the service mesh.
I see. So this is per component. Okay.
Yeah, there's no process.
Gotcha. So there's nothing to compare bare metal to there.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah.
Correct.
All right.
More questions? Okay. Hope I didn't flatten you.
So we haven't run this on current stuff.
That's correct.
Most current stuff.
Yeah. So the automation, in order to make this reproducible, nails down the Linkerd and the Istio versions that we use. A simple patch can update that, basically, to use very recent version. And it's an open source project, so patches are very welcome. If you want to reproduce that, it currently uses the packet infrastructure as a service provider. Yes, please.
Do you have results beyond average? If you know what I mean, like standard deviation of results or things like this?
Yeah, they're not included. They're implicitly included. So that's the error bars, right? If you use the benchmark automation that we have, it'll just create a ton of raw data for you, and that's exactly what you'll probably be looking for in terms of deviations. And we did not use averaging methods like standard deviation. What you're looking at there is the actual deviation that we had from the data points. So what you could do is you could just basically increase spread and get an even better idea of the deviations. So nothing of that is cooked. And if you run rerun the benchmarks yourself, then you'll basically get only raw values. Okay. Thank you very much. It's been fun with you.